We now move on to questions to the Minister for Regional Development, and I call Mr Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Question one to the Minister.
There are currently two schemes being developed for the A24. I'm pleased to advise that my department has invited tenders for the proposed junction improvement scheme on the A24 carried off road at Temple. Construction of this scheme is expected to commence in spring 2016, subject to the successful completion of the tendering and land acquisition processes. A public inquiry into the proposed A24 Ballynahinch bypass concluded on the 27th of January, and the inspector will now consider all of the evidence which has been produced and will prepare a report which will normally include synopsis of the department's supporters and objectors' cases and details of related questions and answers, the inspector's considerations and the inspector's recommendations. It's likely the completed report will normally be submitted to the department for consideration within several months. My officials will then address the inspector's recommendations and prepare a report for my consideration at that time. Having considered all of the issues, I will decide on how the scheme should proceed. The decision will be conveyed in a departmental statement, which will be accompanied by the publication of the inspector's report. Subject to a satisfactory outcome, the notice of intention to proceed and the direction order would also be published. Progression to construction remains subject to the approval of the business case, clearing the statutory procedures and funding being made available to my department.
And I call Mr Lunn for a supplement.
Yes, I thank the Minister for her announcement today. Effectively, it will be very good news for all users of that junction, particularly those who try to turn right from the side roads. And in view of the accident history at that particular point, this is very welcome news indeed. In fact, I can hardly think of a question to ask her. We'll ask, as regards timescale, you've set out the progression of how this goes ahead, but when would you expect actual construction to start? Have you any idea what the timescale would be?
Okay, thank the member for his question, and I'm also very much aware of that particular junction as it borders really on my own constituency, and I would use that route often. Also aware of the collisions on that particular junction. All the tenders are returned by the closing date will be assessed in relation to this project, and the most economically advantageous tender will then be identified. Funding has been set aside for this particular scheme, and it's hoped that it will commence in the spring.
And I call Mr. Jonathan Creed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome what the Minister has said so far regarding the scheme at the Temple Crossroads. It is an extremely dangerous crossroads, Mr. Speaker, and my own father witnessed a fatal accident at that junction. But could the Minister outline, with this work at the Temple, what the approximate cost of the scheme, but more importantly, what additional features are coming along with this scheme?
Thank the member for his question. With regards to the cost, it's estimated somewhere in the region of £1.25 million. And as I said to Mr Lunn, funding has been set aside for the scheme. It is a roundabout at the junction. It's a four-leg roundabout. In addition to the junction improvement, this will also include realignment, a new footway on the approach from the Lisburn side. There will be a 34-space park and share, along with some traffic islands.
And the comments to Sean Rudd.
Thanks, Minister, for your answers thus far. And I too welcome that new good news. But in terms of the Ballynahinch bypass, can you be any more specific in terms of when you expect to get the findings from that public inquiry?
Just with regards to the public inquiry, I'm hopeful that I should hear quite soon with regards to that. Whether it's before PIRDA or not, I'm not clear. But with regards to construction and the earliest date for that, it's possibly early 2018. And again, there's an estimated cost associated with that around £40 to £50 million. So again, that will be subject to that funding being made available.
I call Mr. Jim Mallis.
Thank you. The Minister has confirmed that improving the safety of the junction at the Temple is the key consideration. Can she give me an assurance that the same criteria and consideration will be applied to the Wood Green Junction on the A26 in my constituency, where just 10 days ago we had another fatality of a young person at that junction. Can we have the same safety provision there?
Thank the member for his question, and just like to take this opportunity just to express my sympathy and condolences to the family of the young woman who was tragically killed on the A26. And you'll appreciate that it would be inappropriate for me to comment on the circumstances of that particular tragedy. However, there has been a review of safety around the A26. This review included an examination of all the collisions that have occurred in the last 3 years up to March 2015, for which details are available. Transport NI officials have also met with PSNI staff, traffic safety officers on site to discuss possible engineering and enforcement measures that will not only seek to reduce the severity of collisions but should also reduce the likelihood of them happening in the first instance. I've been informed that this review is substantially complete and it will make a number of recommendations for action along this section of the A26, including at the site of the most recent tragedy.
And the comments of John McAllister.
Number two, Mr. Speaker.
The budget for the Department for Infrastructure, as agreed by the Executive in January, provided a capital allocation of £46 million for road structural maintenance, which I welcome. This will allow for the increased expenditure on maintaining the condition of the existing network and reduce the cost of maintenance in future years. However, capital structural maintenance is only one element of the roads maintenance programme. There are a number of roads maintenance activities that are funded through the resource budget. These include street lighting inspection and maintenance, pothole repairs, grass cutting, gully emptying and weed spraying. These are important aspects of road maintenance in ensuring public safety. A resource allocation of £20 million was provided for roads maintenance in Budget 2016-17, which again I welcome. However, a 5.7% reduction on DFI's overall resource budgets presents a challenging position in terms of delivering services across the department. Together with my officials, I'm taking forward a detailed analysis of all activities which impact on the resource budget for DFI. This will ensure that budget is allocated to maximise service delivery across all aspects of the department, which will obviously include road maintenance activities. I expect this review to conclude in the coming weeks, at which point budgets will be confirmed to all business areas. In the current year, 2015-16, the budget for capital structural maintenance is currently at £39 million. In addition, my department received a resource allocation of £16.5 million in the November monitoring to enable road maintenance activities, including winter service, to be provided. This has enabled a reduction in the backlog of street lighting repairs, pothole repairs and additional gully emptying to be undertaken.
Thank you. And Mr. McAllister for a second.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm grateful to the Minister for a reply. No doubt the Minister will be aware of the extremely wet winter weather we've had and that the toll that that's taking on particularly our rural roads. South Down is suffering as much as anywhere. And that what role and how much pressure and action is she taking as Minister in Transport NI's identification of repairs and indeed identification of erosion and excess water? And can she give an undertaking that potholes will be identified quickly and filled in with hot bitumen rather than the cheaper coal bitumen, as it actually lasts significantly longer? And does her department face...
Had enough questions.
Well, I was only just going to give her a chance to comment on any claims against her.
I thank the member for his question. Obviously, he has a great deal of experience in pothole repairs. I could nearly offer him a job in TNI. But the member will obviously be aware that there is a duty on my department to maintain all public roads in a reasonable condition. And obviously, it's subject to available resources. There are maintenance standards for safety which are in place, and these are designed to ensure a consistent level of service. The standards and procedures have been established regards to the frequency for road inspections. This depends very much on traffic volumes and also specific response times for the repair of defects. Now, I, as everyone else in this chamber, will be aware of there have been issues with regards to response times, but it very much depends on the severity of the defect. It can range from being repaired within one day to actually being then put into a programme of works for the next time that that route is having substantial repairs done to it. These systems and procedures have been tested by the courts. Just with regards to the types of bitumen which is used, obviously he has shown a certain degree of expertise in that. My department carries out repairs using the methods which are recognised by the industry. The traditional repair method using hot bituminous material and spray injection patching, on occasion, as the member has indicated, where there are high priority repairs required, then the coat layers will be used, but that's only as a temporary measure and is in place until further works can be carried out in that area. But be assured that road maintenance is something which I do take seriously, and I've obviously been trying to get additional money for.
Thank you, Minister, for your answer so far. And I mean, I appreciate the Minister did, in terms of road maintenance, you did adopt that position with the road maintenance actually at a very low in terms of the previous Minister. But have you been able to generate any additional funds from your budget coming towards the end of this financial year to actually to drive it towards road maintenance?
I thank the member for his question. And since coming into office, I have been focused on appropriate use of the remaining budget and ensuring that internal efficiencies have been made. All of my department's budget lines and areas of expenditure have been reviewed to ensure as much money as possible has been available for high priority activities such as patching and street lighting maintenance. So what we've done is we've looked at removing all non-essential expenditure on administration, which has generated savings. Staff overtime has been significantly reduced, and it's only permitted when required to deliver prioritised services. Additional savings have been generated from the voluntary exit scheme through a combination of increased staff numbers and staff leaving earlier than originally planned. The relatively mild winter has also allowed some funding that had been set aside for winter service also to be redirected. So I'm pleased to say that since the beginning of January, an additional £3.2 million of resource funding and £2 million of capital funding has been reprioritised for essential maintenance activities such as street lighting, patching, gully emptying, road markings and resurfacing. I believe that this is good news, and I do believe that this will help the local economy and also local councillors and MLAs.
And the comments to Sean Lynch.
Her answer, and I want to thank her also there for the funding that has been rolled out in the recent weeks. However, to follow on the theme of potholes, I came across one yesterday that a car was completely wrecked in. However, I've been given an undertaking that will be fixed this week. But the QPA state that there is £50 million shortfall on the current road maintenance budget. What's your response to that, Minister?
Well, I think I don't actually think we need QPA to tell us that there's been a shortfall in that. I think we're all acutely aware of the challenges around our own constituency. Obviously, I've had regular conversations with QPA. They're aware that since coming into office that I have bid for additional money and have tried to do the best that I can within the very short period of time. I do know that this adds additional pressures onto the industry. It adds pressures onto families who where workers have to go across the water to find work. And again, that impacts on our local economy. It's my job and the job of others in this Assembly to ensure that we do prioritise money in the right direction, and obviously road maintenance is one of those areas.
Mr. Speaker, road maintenance budget allocated through the Executive has been inadequate and reliant on in-year monitoring for many years. but the Quarry Products Association and indeed the Northern Ireland Audit Office have highlighted how important it is to carry out timely repairs and resurfacing, or we end up patching the patches and endless wasted money. So has the Minister recognised the strategic importance of roads maintenance, and what assessment has been made so that we get the balance right between new build and roads maintenance? Can we afford to maintain our existing roads? It would appear not. What does the Minister say?
I thank the member for his question, and having held this position before, his party will be acutely aware of the challenges that there are in relation to that. It's well known that a stitch in time saves nine, and obviously it's important to be able to put as much money into the maintenance of our roads as possible. There is a study which says that we need to put in approximately £141 million per year in order to sustain our network. There will be a backlog, but I think that it's incumbent on all of us to ensure that that money is focused on this particular area.
Mr. Speaker.
Since its inception in 2008, there has been an extensive process of consultations with all those affected by the A5 Western Transport Corridor Scheme. This has taken a number of forms, including a number of public exhibitions at key design stages since the scheme's inception in 2008. Regular updates to directly affected landowners through both meetings and by letter at key stages in development of the scheme. Formal consultation with over 30 different statutory authorities and organisations as part of the studies and assessments which have been undertaken during the preparation of the orders and environmental statement for the scheme. This includes the Department of Agriculture and Rural Development, Northern Ireland Environment Agency and the LOCS Agency. In addition, the scheme has a dedicated project website, www.a5wtc.com, and an 0845 telephone contact line. This website has supported the overall consultation strategy for the project, providing an additional means by which statutory, public and private stakeholders have been given access to scheme updates and announcements. My officials are not aware of farming groups living along the proposed A5 dual carriageway route, although some landowners have chosen to involve the Ulster Farmers Union, and officials have met with the Ulster Farmers Union both generally and as and when requested by individual landowners. I also met with the Ulster Farmers Union only last week to discuss both the A5 scheme and the Land Acquisition and Compensation Bill. In December, I invited the landowners' agents to meet with me to discuss both theirs and landowners' concerns around the scheme.
Mr. McGuinness for a supplement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and could I thank the Minister for her very detailed answer. Could I ask the Minister, though, is she fully satisfied that everything has been covered really in relation to consultation? Because if not, you could then subsequently come across unexpected roadblocks, if I might put it that way, in terms of the actual development of the scheme, and that must be avoided at all costs. So is the Minister fully satisfied that such consultation as necessary has in fact taken place?
I thank the member for his question, and as you'll be aware, I announced the start of a new set of consultations on the new statutory draft statutory orders, a new environmental statement for the scheme. The current consultation exercise formally commenced on the 16th of February and will conclude on the 4th of April. It is likely that this could lead to another public inquiry on the scheme, and as such we've tentatively programmed in this for autumn 2016. Obviously it's very much subject to the completion of all the procedures and then moving forward from there. It's very difficult at this stage really to anticipate what may come up during those consultations, but certainly I would be keen to ensure that as many of the issues which can be resolved are resolved in advance of a public inquiry.
Commissioner Alistair Patterson.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. And I thank I note the response of the Minister thus far. And as she has noted, we will soon see the Land Acquisition Compensation Bill pass through this House, which will bring parity for those in Northern Ireland affected by projects such as the A5. Will the Minister ensure measures are in place to maintain parity should there be further enhancements in the level of compensation as may be awarded in England and Wales in the future?
Thank the member for his question and also the fact that he's recognised that we have moved forward with this piece of legislation, which I believe has been widely welcomed. At this stage, I'm unaware of the detail of what may be brought in across the water, but I'll certainly advise my officials and ask that that obviously be considered while we're going through the process of this bill.
I'm going to call Mrs. Paula Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question 4.
My department has no current proposals to provide a pedestrian crossing at this roundabout. The present layout already includes facilities to assist pedestrians crossing. These include pedestrian refuge islands with lowered curbs, along with tactile paving for the visually impaired. I am aware, however, that a site meeting with Transport NI officials has been arranged for later this month with local elected representatives to discuss difficulties which a disabled resident is currently experiencing when crossing at this junction. This meeting will obviously allow Transport NI to consider possible measures to improve conditions for pedestrians crossing at this busy junction. TNI considers all such requests for controlled pedestrian crossings against set criteria, which takes into account the speed and volume of traffic and the demand for pedestrians and other vulnerable users to cross a road at a particular location. Usually surveys will be carried out to determine the peak demand for crossing movements. On occasions, even where the criteria is met, it can be difficult or impossible to provide a crossing at the desired crossing point, and it may be necessary to locate the crossing a short distance away. Where control crossing is not deemed necessary but there is a sufficient demand, other measures such as pedestrian refuge islands and drop curbs may be considered instead.
And Ms. Paula Bradley for
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her answer. This pedestrian crossing is an extremely busy area on the boundary of North Belfast and South Antrim, leading to Glengormley, to Sandy Nose, to Ballyclare, to Larne. And not only is it a high amount of traffic, but a heck of amount of pedestrians. I myself had to walk that route every day when my children were young and at school, so I know only too well the problems that arise from that. And you're absolutely right, we do have a meeting later on this month. But can I just ask the Minister, has there been any history of any collisions there? And if we were to get any type of pedestrian crossing, have any idea what could be planned for that area?
Thank the member for a question. Just with regards to collision history at the roundabout, there have been 6 personal injury collisions at this junction during the most recent 3-year period where PSNI collision data is available. Of these, 3 have involved cyclists and motorcyclists, both considered to be vulnerable road users. There have, however, been no reported collisions involving pedestrians during the same period. But TNI will be carrying out an overall review of the safety of this junction with particular emphasis on vulnerable road users. I do recognise that this is a busy junction and obviously it's very local to the member. Any formal crossing facilities would have to be carefully sited so as not to be too close to junctions or to compromise any private entrances. Normally they take the form of puffin or toucan crossings, and at some sites there are zebra crossings. So I hope that answers the question for the member.
I call Mr. William Humphrey.
Your question number 5.
I am fully committed to the delivery of Belfast Rapid Transit, including not only the current phase but also future extensions to the north and south of the city. Belfast Rapid Transit is a transformational public transport project for the city. It represents a great opportunity for Belfast going forward and is a major undertaking by my department in support of an executive priority. in order to assess the viability of potential Belfast rapid transit routes to North and South Belfast, my department has already undertaken surveys. The results of these, along with passenger information and existing data sets, are being used in the development of a new transport model for Belfast. The model will enable my department to assess potential options for the extension of Belfast rapid transit and to prepare a business case for the extension of the system to North and South Belfast. Any future extension of the system will, of course, be subject to the availability of funding. My department is continuing to engage with those responsible for current and proposed developments on potential future routes for BRT, including the Department for Social Development and the University of Ulster, just to ensure, as far as possible, that the future provision of Belfast Rapid Transit is key to those key areas isn't prejudiced.
I call Mr Humphrey for a sub.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer. Can I ask the Minister, has a route been identified for North Belfast, and what is the likely timescale for its operation and implementation?
My department has not yet identified the preferred route option for the extension of BRT to serve North Belfast, as with the first phase of BRT, which is currently being implemented. The route options will be subject to detailed analysis and public consultation. There are a number of potential route options in North Belfast, which would include Shore Road, Antrim Road and the Crumlin Road. Obviously, the success of high frequency and high occupancy rapid transit system relies on achieving significant patronage levels. So whilst the route has not yet been identified, it would appear that based on current bus patronage levels and the potential for future growth, the Antrim Road is likely to emerge as the preferred option. With regards to a timeline for this, it's very much dependent on the success of the first phase of Belfast Rapid Transit Network and also available funding for that. However, subject to those caveats, an outline provisional timeline for the extension to North Belfast is as follows. 2017-18, prepare the options assessment. 2018-19, prepare a business case. Following assessment, the commencement of the first phase. 2019-20, detailed design and implementation. And 2022-23, I would hope that it would be operational.
And the comments of Cathal Boylan.
Margaret, I can't call you. Thank you, Mr Speaker. Could I just ask the Minister what discussions, if any, has there been with the taxi industry in relation to any of these proposals in terms of rapid transit?
My department, as you'll understand, is in regular contact with the taxi service, and this will continue throughout this project.
And Sir Nelson McCaws.
Question number six, please.
I recognise the importance of supporting this development, and clearly public transport will be critical. I recently met officials from the University of Ulster, and I understand it is working closely with TransLink. Future plans to encourage students to access the new campus by public transport will include a range of direct bus services, discounted ticketing options, and a wide range of promotional activity. Currently, York Gate rail station has capacity to deal with greater numbers of passengers. TransLink will improve bus links from the station and is working with Transport NI on improved walkways and cycleways. TransLink has also looked at the possibility of providing a new station at Gamble Street. However, to operate a new station on the line at this location will require the existing single line Dargan Viaduct to be reconstructed to twin track. This is because a delay to each train on the single line section for services from Larne and Londonderry could not be justified. A recent review indicated that the single line across the Dargan Viaduct will be sufficient for projected passenger growth well into the next decade. To justify the track dualling earlier would require a sufficiently robust business case and consideration of impacts across the whole rail network. There is also a question of timing. Reconstructing reconstructing the viaduct to take twin track will most probably require an extended period of closure of that line, which obviously brings with it its own difficulties.
And I'm sorry, there isn't time for the supplementary questions. We now move on to topical questions, and I call Mr. Alistair Patterson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Recently, the Minister announced funding for works to raise roads in Fermanagh as a result of the flooding issues, which of course I do welcome. Can I ask the Minister for an indication as to when the work on raising these roads will be completed, and can she outline what assessments were carried out to establish these particular roads as the key roads for allocation of funding?
I thank the member for his question, and indeed my department has received over £1 million to develop a package of road improvements across Fermanagh and other parts of Northern Ireland to mitigate against future flooding. There were over 50 roads were flooded in the Fermanagh area during the most recent flooding event, and three main crossings of Upper Loch Earn are considered to be to provide the greatest public benefit, and funding is initially being targeted towards those schemes. Those three schemes are the B55 Wattlebridge Road, the C436 Inishmore Road, and the B127 Newbridge Road. My officials are currently looking at options and costings for the engineering of those schemes.
Mr. Patterson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her response in relation to these three particular roads, of which 625,000 has been allocated, which does in some ways seem like a drop in the loch to complete the raising of these roads. It is also maybe an indication that the Executive still seems unprepared to tackle the wider issues of the flooding issues in Fermanagh. Can the Minister confirm, will these projects be completed entirely with the flooding fund, or will substantial amount of money be taken from the DRD budget for 2016-2017?
I thank the member for his question, and obviously this money will go some way to correcting those issues and addressing those issues in Fermanagh. I don't think that, and I think the member is right in saying that this will not rectify all the problems in Fermanagh, but at least it will be starting to give some sort of headway towards that. Additional monies may be sought during various other rounds of monitoring for other roads that are identified, but at this stage we're still we're identifying further roads if they're required. You will be aware that previous works in the past actually did help. I know that not all roads were successful, but the majority of those roads were able to remain open as a result of previous works. I plan, as other executive members are planning to be in Fermanagh on Thursday, and I hope to meet with engineers on a number of those sites then, and I can discuss this issue further.
And I call Mr. Ross Hussey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I'm sure that the Minister will not be surprised that I'll be asking her a question in relation to the A5. I was in the Ballymagorry area on Saturday, and I did a tour with the local residents, and I was shown the Locks Walk, which is basically a circular walkway on the boundaries of the village. The proposed route of the A5 crosses the Greenlaw Road and Park Road, basically cutting off this walkway. Will the Minister confirm that as part of the consultation process she will give serious consideration to protecting this specific area so the locals can continue to enjoy the walk?
And I thank the member for his question, and as he has identified, there are some alterations are proposed to the Locks Walk area. However, it is my understanding that my department intends to ensure that there is public access to this area, and this will be maintained. Obviously, there's an opportunity for further during the consultation process for this to be raised. I'm happy to speak to my officials with regards to the area in question, and will write to the member.
I'm going to call Mr. Hussey first.
Again, I thank the Minister for her response. I think that type of response will be greatly appreciated by the people of Ballymagorry, and again, just thank you for your letter.
Member for that, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wonder, could I ask the Minister if the Minister would recognise the potential of the Cumber Greenway?
And I thank the member for his question, and obviously that's a Greenway, which is close to my heart, falling within my own constituency. I do see that there is a tremendous potential to develop greenways right across Northern Ireland, just not along the Cumber Greenway. I'm very keen to harness that potential to deliver a network which is safe and convenient, traffic-free routes, just to increase sustainable travel and also opportunities to improve health and wellbeing throughout using sort of recreational areas such as this. I was recently in Edinburgh and in Holland, where I was able to see what they have made of their greenways and the potential that there is for them. I'm currently developing a strategic plan for greenways across Northern Ireland, and obviously the Cumber Greenway has particular potential given the large catchments areas that there are and links to the new Conswater Community Greenway, which I also had the opportunity to visit very recently.
Okay, Mr. Newton for sub.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? And she mentioned the Conswater Greenway, which she has seen. Would it be the Minister's intention that the Cumber Greenway would come up to the same standard as the Conswater Greenway?
I thank the member for his question, and of course I would like to see that that be the case. As he said, I visited the Conswater Greenway, and it really is something very special, and I would recommend anyone who hasn't had the opportunity to see that work as it's progressing to go to that area. I do see that there are opportunities for enhanced for lighting in the first instance on the Cumber Greenway, and also better signage and better links to communities off the Greenway. I want to explore the best way in order to do that, and obviously greater links with the local councils as well with regards to the Cumber Greenway in particular. I've given my support to an application by Sustrans for EU funding to increase usage of the Cumber Greenway, and I hope to see the benefits of that.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Cahill.
Cormagat, Cian Coyle, and could I thank the Minister for her answers previously, and I want to touch a wee bit on the road maintenance budget and ask the question on behalf of the good people of rural Newry and Armagh. Minister, just could you outline what actions you're taking to ensure that the roads are maintained in a safe and roadworthy condition in the likes of rural Newry and Armagh? Ballymagorry.
I thank the member for his question, and I recently met the member to discuss a range of issues, particularly around the Newry and Armagh area, and I'm aware that he's also met with local Transport NI officials to address the concerns that he has. As I said in previous in responses to questions today, that road maintenance is a priority. Since coming into office, I've ensured that money has been directed to that particularly, along with other maintenance issues. So I would like to think that before the end of the term, that he will see the benefits of that additional money. And I do admit that it's not enough, but it's still going some way to address some of the areas of concern.
Mr. Boylan for supplement.
Gormagat Cian Coyle, and could I thank the Minister for her answer, but could I ask the Minister, as part of her legacy and leaving this old department as DRD, will she give a commitment and assurance to this House that the money for the 16-17 budget year, is that money is prioritised for the maintenance of rural roads? I think in a previous answer the Minister talked about doing the roads that carries the most volume of traffic, but she would understand that the rural roads have been neglected for long many a day. Would she give a commitment to prioritising that money for the rural roads maintenance? Coramila Mogget.
I thank the member for his question, and the case is well made. As somebody who also represents a rural constituency, I am very aware of the needs for rural roads as well, and that would certainly be reiterated by many in this chamber. So while I can give a commitment that I will seek to get as much money as possible into the roads budget, it's very much dependent on local divisions as well as to how they allocate their money, and obviously those areas of highest priority, and it's about making a case for those particular areas.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the Minister for her answer so far. Now that the date's confirmed for the EU referendum, can you outline any planning or any audit that your department have done about potential funding that might be lost if we are withdrawn from the European Union in the summer?
I thank the member for her question, and as she'll be aware, this has only been agreed this weekend. So given the fact that it's only Monday, I haven't quite got to the stage of getting that information, but I plan to do that within the near future.
Anna, for a supplementary.
Can I ask the Minister specifically if her department applied for any money in Interreg's latest open call, which is worth, I think, potentially £34 million to Northern Ireland for cross-border transport, and if there are any specific cross-border transport projects that she feels may be at risk in the event of a Brexit?
There are a number of projects which my department is currently undertaking with regards to sourcing EU funding, and I mentioned one with regards to obviously the Greenways. The one particular one would be in regards to Londonderry Transport Hub, which would have a cross-border dimension to it. What I will do is I'll speak to officials and get detail of the information which the member has requested and get that to her.
Peter,
thank you, Mr. Speaker. And moving from wider European issues to the more narrowly focused local issues, can I ask the Minister for an update on sewage improvement works in North Down?
Thank the member for his question. In North Down, Northern Ireland Water is investing in sewer network through maintenance activities as well as addressing flooding issues. There are a number of schemes in North Down in construction or nearing the construction phase. These include a number of schemes relating to dealing with unsatisfactory intermittent discharges. We have the Clandy Boys Stream Phase 2A, which is in construction, which is £1.7 million. Phase 2B, which is nearing construction, which is £3.6 million. We have the Rathmore Stream, which is nearing construction, costing £200,000. And Belfast Lock, which is nearing construction, costing £2 million. In addition, and it's not within the member's constituency, it was in my own, but we have the £250,000 Kirkcubbin Drainage Area Plan combined sewer overflow upgrade, which is nearing construction.
Mr. Weir, first.
I thank the Minister for her response. Can I ask her specifically on improvement works in the Mullyle area?
Again, thank the member for his question. The Mullyle Sewerage Improvement Scheme is currently at construction stage. The project is aimed at improving bathing water, reducing the risk of flooding, as well as enhancing the coastal area. The project involves the construction of a new underground pumping station in the car park seafront area of Mullyle. It also includes the laying of approximately 340 metres of sewage pumping main, which is substantially complete, with the exception of the final connections. It's anticipated that the overall programme of work will be completed in the summer of 2016.
And I call Mr. Paul Given.
Mr. Speaker, recently the Minister met with myself and some of my Assembly colleagues and local councillors in respect of the Knockmore Sprucefield link. Would the Minister be able to provide an update from those meetings?
Thank the member for his question. Indeed, in January I met with members of Lisburn and Castlereagh Council to discuss the proposal, and I can confirm that my department will undertake a preliminary assessment of the traffic impacts of Knockmore Link, and the results of this should be available in March. I'd expect the results to provide objective evidence for further discussion between Transport NI and Lisburn and Castlereagh City Council officers.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? Associated with the Knockmore Sprucefield link, particularly along the Knockmore Road, are junction improvements that are required as a result of planning articles and housing associated with that. Could the Minister provide some update in respect of those junctions in what is commonly known as the LD1 area?
Again, I thank the member for his question. My understanding is TNI are in ongoing negotiations with the development consortia for the financing and building of the three junctions at LD1 site. I would expect that these discussions between TNI, Lisburn, Castlereagh City Council planning officers and the developer's agent will continue to facilitate the agreed junction improvements to be implemented. I've agreed to visit the site and meet with the developers afterwards just to discuss the scheme.
Thank you, and that ends the period for questions. Thank you very much, Minister. And just take a ease while we change the top table.